Video games exist to entertain players, and as such, they generally have to stand by and say nothing when their player is acting like a total jackass.
You know how hard we work on this f***ing game? Piece of s***. You don't even know. You have no f***ing idea. Oh, this game, quiplash, it's boring. F*** you. What are you doing playing here then?
Generally, damn, Quiplash! Even more effective for conveying disapproval than being yelled at, though, is when a game communicates how it isn't angry with you, just disappointed. Via a stern lecture, a pointed reminder how it's your own time you're wasting, or our favourite, some good old-fashioned passive-aggressiveness. So, brace yourself for 7 games that weren't angry with you, they were just disappointed that you can't seem to straighten up and fly right. Enjoy! If you can.
Listen. I want to talk to the partners directly. Make them understand why all of this is happening. And that terminal gives me an idea.
Throughout most of the Hitman games, Agent 47's handler is Diana, the ice-cool, always-in-control, all-seeing eye, who guides you through your missions, pointing out opportunities, identifying your targets, and of course, congratulating you on a job well done, regardless of how messy the kill was or how you're dressed at the time.
Caruso.
Target down. Next up, Francesca DeSantis.
Yeah, great job, 47. No notes. In Hitman 3, however, there are a few times when Diana isn't a constant reassuring voice in your ear. One example being the first mission, On Top of the World, set in the world's tallest building in Dubai. In this mission, you're being guided by Lucas Gray, who has a score to settle with shady Illuminati-style organization Providence.
All right, I'm no hacker like Olivia, but I think you need to pull one of the racks here to gain access to the terminal. Damn it, a silent alarm has been tripped. Security is on its way. Hide, 47.
I mean, he's no Diana, let's put it that way. Anyway, Gray asks you to set up a scenario where the two targets are together in the same room so he can FaceTime them and tell them how much they suck and how much he rules, and with the world's greatest assassin under his guidance, that's exactly what happens.
What's this? Carl? Did you do that?
I certainly did not. I have no idea what's going on. Gentlemen.
The way this is supposed to play out is you let Gray perform his gloating soliloquy before acting as the instrument of his revenge.
7. Finish it. Finally, Stuyvesant and Ingram are gone.
Or if you prefer, you can just kill the target straight away, totally undermining his thoroughly prepared scheme.
Not a patient man, are you?
This is great because the developers clearly anticipated it, and as such, Gray is equipped with several dejected responses.
That was unexpectedly fast.
Best of all is this one, though. You can just feel the disappointment coming off him in waves.
Oh, okay. Well done. I guess.
Not now, Gray. I'm teabagging the corpse. World's greatest assassin!
A slightly different take here on video game disappointment from Batman Arkham Knight, a game in which Batman spends a lot of his time using his fancy remote hacking device to hack such unbreakable passwords as the word biochemistry to get into the airship of a biochemist. My dude, at least use a number and a special character. Amateur hour. One person who is a bit more secure with their doors is Johnny Charisma, the former singer turned Joker lookalike, who uses an old-fashioned analog keypad to keep Batman out.
This lock is mechanical with no digital components. I won't be able to use the remote hacking device.
Luckily for the world's greatest detective, the keypad is directly opposite a security camera, so he should be able to watch Charisma enter the code. Unluckily, however, Charisma is in the way, blocking the correct sequence from view, no matter how much X-ray vision you have. The solution to this puzzle is to look in the mirror next to Johnny Charisma, where you can see the keypad reflected, and figure out the combination. Of course, if you're all zoomed in, you might miss this and be trying a variety of other options to get through the door, an angle of approach that Batman Arkham Knight has only so much patience for, because if you take too long to solve this puzzle, Batman will get frustrated and then just punch a giant hole in the lock to teach you a lesson about not wasting Batman's time.
This is taking too long.
Which, amazingly, works. Why didn't you just do that in the first place, Batman? Would have saved us both a lot of effort.
What has become of this city? There used to be laws. Justice. Not anymore. Crime is out of control. Cats are missing, and townspeople are being victimized.
Oh, hey! Who pooped on my porch?
What's going on with you? Whoa!
The most tantalizing kind of puzzle in a video game is one that you can see early on in the game, but that you don't have the solution to yet. Then you come back later on, fully powered up and armed with the knowledge you need to solve it, concrete proof of your progression, and oh, the game's over.
Yes.
If this too is a worry of yours, you might be tempted to look up the solution to puzzles on the internet, so that you can reap the rewards early and not have to worry about forgetting and missing out. And in most games, if you can live with yourself, that's a sound strategy with no repercussions. Not in South Park The Fractured But Whole, however, which knows exactly what you're up to if you somehow enter a correct code on a keypad lock before you're supposed to have discovered it.
You. Mom.
Hey, Tom Brady, you want to play the game or do you just want to be known as a smug, cheating bitch the rest of your life?
Try this and you'll be confronted by Cartman, who is here to give you a stern lecture about your cheating, which is apparently like something that happened in American football.
Okay, so I guess you just want to Tom Brady your way through the whole game? What's the matter, can't do it on your own?
Involving Tom Brady? Anyway, he's not angry, he's just disappointed.
You. Mom.
Is this fun for you, Tom Brady?
And he'll keep doing it. As long as you do.
You, Mom.
You broke the rules, me.
Gosh, I wish I knew anything about American football. I bet this is brilliant satire. To be fair though, Cartman, it is your password, and the password was F you, Mom. I didn't exactly have to be a genius to figure that out.
I've been waiting for you, Mr. Winters.
How do you know my name?
Anyone who is anyone has heard of the likes of you. A hero searching for his daughter.
Literally everything in Resident Evil Village is trying to kill you. Zombies. Goats. Kindly old men who suddenly go feral. So you'd think if you were to somehow find someone who isn't actively trying to drive a piece of farming equipment through your head in this horrible village, you'd want to keep that person on your side, right?
I am but a humble merchant.
Here?
Oh, forgive my manners. Call me the Duke. Now to business. Weapons, ammunition, healing salves, anything you desire, I can provide.
Well, the good news is that such a person exists. The Duke, village's resident non-evil merchant who can be found in a variety of cozy-looking nooks and alcoves throughout the game, ready to sell you supplies, upgrade your weapons, and even cook up a spot of lunch.
Apologies for the wait. Here's your share.
The bad news is that the second some players saw this jovial shopkeeper, their minds immediately turned to murder, and as such, tried to off the Duke with every weapon they had to hand.
A lovely weapon, sir!
Somehow, possibly because they've been making video games for 42 years, Capcom saw this coming, and as such, Resident Evil Village is prepared for your shenanigans. Sure, the Duke is capable of passive-aggressive praise for the power of your weapons.
My! That's a lot of destructive power.
But most of the time, he just reacts with a kind of bored amusement as you try your best to murder and kill him to death. There's no anger here, just the world-weary disappointment of a game that 100% knew this was coming, tinged with a little concern about how you're going to actually finish the game if you keep using your explosives to try and murder the guy who sells you healing fluid.
You be careful not to waste your ammunition.
I appreciate the concern, Duke. Ooh, how about several landmines?
A lovely weapon, sir.
All right, fine.
Probe launched.
The life of a space captain isn't just exciting gunfights, space makeouts, and pushing people out of windows, you know.
I've got nothing more to say to you. If you shoot me, my team...
I mean, that is like 80-85% of it, sure, but there are other slightly more utilitarian tasks for you to complete if you want to get the most out of Mass Effect 2. And no, I'm not just talking about feeding your space fish. Although you definitely should do that too. I am, in fact, referring to the side mission that requires you to collect mineral resources for the UNC by travelling to distant planets, scanning them, and then launching probes to extract all their precious natural resources from the comfort of space, where you don't have to see any of the unpleasant environmental consequences of your remote interstellar fracking trip.
In research projects, platinum is used to upgrade sniper rifles, shotguns, and medical equipment. Launching probe.
The different planets you visit are graded according to their mineral deposits, with rich and good planets providing all the resources you'll need to carry you through the game. As such, scanning a planet rated poor is a waste of time, fuel, and expensive probes, unless you want to make a rude and immature joke, of course.
Launching probe.
That's because one of the planets you can scan and probe is Uranus, and due to it being a depleted planet, which is even worse than poor, literally the only reason you're going to be doing this is so that you can giggle to yourself at the fact that you are probing Uranus. However, Mass Effect 2 is always one step ahead and has already predicted where your mind will go, as Edie, your ship's AI, will greet your request to probe Uranus with a not angry, but disappointed, world-weary, "Really, Commander?"
"Really, Commander?"
"Yes, Edie, really. Who's captain here?"
"Probe Uranus."
"Yeah, that's what I thought. I'll get to saving the galaxy right after this, I swear."
"All the cars are in place now.
If you're a fan of the sport of Formula One in the 1990s, you'll be instantly familiar with the commentary of the now sadly departed Murray Walker, a man who has been affectionately described as sounding like his trousers are on fire.
"Unbelievable! He's locked up flying stuff!"
We shouldn't joke, he probably accidentally sat down in some flammable race fuel or something. Having broadcast his first Grand Prix way back in 1949, Murray was so inextricably linked to the sport at the time that there was no question that he'd also appear in the officially licensed Formula One video games on the original PlayStation, including this game, F1 97.
"It's Tarlo! He probably left a bit of tyre rubber on that barrier."
The result was one of the rare occasions in a racing game where you, the driver, are getting broadcast commentary piped directly into your helmet.
"Only one more lap to go. That's heavy on the brakes through that part."
A bit distracting, sure, but the alternative is hearing Murray's usually brilliant co-commentator, Martin Brundle, reciting the Formula One rulebook, seemingly bored out of his mind.
"With the 107% rule of the past couple of years, we're seeing that the tail end teams have had to sharpen up their act and spend longer making sure they can do competitive time. This means that the gap between the qualifying times from the front to the back of the grid is now much less."
You can't really hear it, but I'm pretty sure he mouthed the words "help me" at the end there. The most crushing thing to hear in the middle of a race, though, is the clear disappointment of Formula One's most beloved and respected commentator. Something that happened specifically if you spun the car 180 degrees and petulantly drove backwards around the circuit.
"It's truly! I cannot believe this! He's actually driving the wrong way round the circuit!"
Carry on charging around the circuit in the wrong direction, and poor old Murray becomes increasingly incredulous.
"What is he doing? In all my years of commentating on Formula One, I've never seen anything like it."
By that point, he'd been in Formula One 48 years, if you're wondering exactly how much of an idiot you're being. Still, there's no lasting animosity from old Murray. Start driving sensibly again, and he's right back in your corner, to the point where he celebrates a successful practice lap like you've just won the world championship.
"Yes! His times are really coming down."
I guess he recognises exactly how hard it is to steer one of these things on an original PlayStation controller.
Come on, man. Damn, you all right?
Never better.
So what now?
Looks like I'm gonna have to postpone my retirement. Ah, man, I'm mortgaged up to my eyeballs. Look, I only know one way to make money. I'm gonna have to give an old friend a call.
Probably the most interesting thing about Grand Theft Auto V was its three protagonists and their wildly differing personalities. Irascible put-upon Michael, ambitious naive Franklin, and Trevor.
Yeah, I need some breakfast.
Yeah, these characters and their differences is what drove the story, and whether or not they'll be able to work together to pull off the big score is a big part of what keeps the game compelling. Of course, if you want to undermine all that, you can just drive to Michael's house and start firing rockets at it. This is Grand Theft Auto, so naturally Rockstar expects the players to try and screw with every single aspect of the game, and of course, they anticipated this happening, which is why, when you start hammering Michael's house with heavy artillery, he sends you a peeved text message asking you if it is, in fact, you firing rockets at his house. Heavy disappointed dad vibes here. You can keep doing it, and if you keep it up, you might even get a slightly perturbed phone call from Michael, once again asking if you wouldn't mind knocking off the barrage of ordnance you've unleashed on his home, where his family lives.
Stop firing rockets at my house!
I'm out of ammo!
Yeah, I'm kind of busy right now, Michael. Call me back once I finish stacking these cars up in your driveway and setting them on fire.
Thank you so much for watching this video about the 7 times games weren't angry with you, they were just disappointed. If you could like the video, that would super help us out, and if you aren't already subscribed, please do consider hitting that subscribe button and the little bell notification icon to be notified when we make a video. You don't have to do it, but if you don't, we won't be angry, we'll just be disappointed. But also extremely angry.